Well, I'm running down the road with Barbera in tow. I got 15 titles on my mind. 7 world ones, 1 hardcore, and 7 tags with 4 different guys. Take her easy, take her easy. Don't let the sound of gongs and bells drive you crazy. Lights up and raise my hands. Don't even try to understand the supernatural dead man. So take her easy. Well, I'm standing on the corner of Death Valley, California. Such a bright fire I see. It's my house, my Lord, burned to the floor. Lost my parents, brother, everything. Come on, Katie, please don't blame me. Paul Barrett took me in as his and tried to train me. Rarely lose, I usually win. I never thought I'd see you again. You opened up the cell and climbed in so freaking easy. Running down the road and I'm all on my own. Got a decade of destruction. Call me big evil, not Booger Red, but do call me American. Take her easy, take her easy. Don't let the sound of Limp Bizkit drive you crazy. Come on, Vince. Bury me. I'm coming back as the dead man. So take her easy.
All right, creatures of the night. Welcome to episode 158 of Talking Taker, our encyclopedic exploration digging over the career of the greatest professional wrestling character of all time, The Undertaker. My name is Alex Dorio, and I want to thank you for joining us for yet another round of Dead Man Talking. And I am joined, as always, by my tag team partner, my wrestling buddy. He is the man of my dreams, my sweet, sweet fantasy baby, Mr. Travis White. And Travis, we are doing just that. We are exploring our dreams. We are exploring our deepest, darkest, dark side of the night fantasies here. No, no. Get your minds out of the gutter, folks. We're still talking about The Undertaker. We're still talking about the dead man. But after 3 years of exploring 150 plus of The Undertaker's pay-per-view matches, 20 plus years of his career, we're going to take a detour off the road with our encyclopedic exploration, off the road with our time traveling hearse, and we're going to talk about all of the Undertaker matches that never did take place.
Well, it's because they say it's your birthday. I mean, that's why. It's our 3-year anniversary ish, you know, but a little bit, you know, but we're not as bad as WWE. Remember that? What was that 1 year we covered? It was like, oh, Raw anniversary. It was like in October. Like,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. The birthday's not until January. So, yeah, we're only like a week off or something, but it just worked out to finish up WrestleMania storyline with Sean and then take a week break and then head into the rest of 2010. So, yeah, it's our 3-year birthday here. So, yeah, happy birthday.
Consider these our birthday wishes, you know, and yeah. Like we said, we started this podcast about 3 years ago, and, you know, maybe a foolish endeavor, who knows, looking back on it, but these would not have been foolish endeavors. We are looking exactly back, you know, we started this podcast because The Undertaker, his career spanned 30 years. It spanned so many guys, all the way from Dusty Rhodes and Jimmy Snuka to AJ Styles and Roman Reigns and Drew McIntyre, everybody, so many guys in between. And yet, as we've been going along, man, you and I, when we talk off air and when we brainstorm about things, there's just, we keep thinking of all these guys like, man, I wish Taker would have had a match with this guy. It would have been so cool. There's so many guys he did have matches with, you know. Even just little TV matches like your Nunzios and your Tajiris and your random guys like that, yeah. Shelton Benjamins. But then there's so many that he not only never had a pay-per-view match with, but just never had a match with, period. So we're going to experiment a little bit tonight. We're going to do something we've never really done before. We're going to kind of go back and forth and fantasy book some different eras of Undertaker's career, talk about some alternate universe opponents he might have faced. We're going to brainstorm if The Undertaker had possibly been a part of different companies throughout his career, like WCW, ECW, TNA, New Japan, NXT, AEW. Who are some of the cool guys he could have faced in those times? And, you know, now that The Undertaker is allegedly officially retired, sadly, there really is no chance for these matches to happen.
Right, exactly. So, yeah, this has been a fun little trip. And again, full disclosure, we have not shared these with each other. You know, usually, you know, we send our notes or stuff and hit the highlights, you know, just so we can check over it. But we have not done that with this. So this is all fresh for each of us. So I'm sure we have a lot of the same guys because, you know, we have the same taste and stuff like that. And there's just some glaring omissions as far as pay-per-view quality opponents that he's never had, you know. And then there's guys like Big Show. He's wrestled 140 times, you know, on pay-per-view. Yes. Or Mabel and stuff like that. So it's just like, you know, there's some that stand out. It's like, why on earth? Or Luther Reigns and stuff like that. So these are ones like, let's redeem those Luther Reigns matches. Let's redeem those Heidenreich ones. Let's get some good stuff there. These are ones we wish we could have covered on a pay-per-view. So.
Yes, the legacy of Undertaker opponents is vast and it is legendary. But once again, you got your Luther Reigns. You've got your Giant Gonzalez's. You got your Kamala's. Rest in peace. As fun as they might be, I might trade one of those Kamala matches for some of these matches. You got like five Mr. Kennedy matches and five or six Randy Orton matches. And as you mentioned, 100 Big Show matches. And we couldn't just trade a few of those for some of these would be nice. But so this will be different. You know, like we said, we both have got about 25 or 30 guys on our list. And there's going to be, like you said, a lot of crossover. There's some obvious ones that we have to and we want to talk about. Some of the, you know, I'm sure everybody's got a few of those on their mind and we'll get to them and try to think about how those matches might have looked. But I think, I think we're going to try to stump each other maybe and try to get each other with some ones maybe the other person didn't think of. And then towards the end of the show, anything that we missed, we'll go through your comments. We got a ton of feedback from you guys, and we appreciate that over the past few days on all our social media. So we'll pick up on those that we missed and say some of our favorites from those, because you guys surprised me with stuff that I would have never thought of, but had some great ideas on there.
Yeah, this is one of our most like interactive episodes we've done, like before we actually record. So because it's so fun to think about, you know, like who could, like what could have been, you know. So yeah, thank you guys for that, and we'll get to those at the end here. So,
well, the way we talked about doing this is we're kind of go in sort of chronological order. So we'll start in the earlier days, some of those opponents he might have faced then. Then we'll move through the different eras a little bit, and there'll be some crossover, and you know, there's no perfect format to do this, but let's start with a bang.
We'll have guys that, you know, were in WCW that migrated to WWE, and so like he could have faced them multiple times or whatever. So yeah, we'll get to all that, but it's fluid.
Yeah, and you guys out there, you may agree, you may disagree. We'd love to hear your opinions afterward. But let's start with a bang, Travis. Let's start with one of the obvious ones. I know it was on your list. Back to the earliest days of Undertaker here. And this is one that maybe technically could not have taken place. This is a guy who had his last WWE match just about 6-7 months before The Undertaker came into the company. So, man, it's just so close to crossing over, but it's a guy that we have obviously talked about many, many times in this podcast as sort of, you know, parallel in a lot of different ways. And I'm talking about the original WWE, WWF Hall of Famer, the eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant, man. He was the Phenom of his generation and sort of that backbone and cornerstone of the WWF through the 80s. Sort of Vince's kind of right-hand guy, he admired so much. And then The Undertaker kind of took the torch from him. But it would have been amazing had Andre hung on for just a few more months to literally pass the torch to Undertaker in the ring.
Yeah, that's my number one, like, just from chronologically, that's just the first one I had on my list, too, just because, yeah, it just would have been so cool to have seen that. Again, especially that early Undertaker time, too, when he was, you know, the dead guy, like the zombie, more monster-like character. It would have been cool to see Andre in there going against that, you know, and how who sells in that match? Like, who knows? It would have been fun, man. But just, again, this is a feather in the cap of saying, you know, Taker got to go one-on-one with Andre. It would have been really, really neat. So
here's my proposal. Let's say Andre hangs on for another year. You know, he doesn't have to work a ton. He just does. Right. I mean, he wasn't doing much back then.
He'll do the Undertaker schedule.
Exactly.
The later years Undertaker schedule, yeah.
Let's say Andre is the guy that Undertaker beats at WrestleMania 7 instead of Jimmy Snuka. What if that was like the beginning of the streak was him defeating Andre the Giant? Like, that
would have been awesome.
That's feasible. You could imagine something like that.
They could have done that. I think Andre would have been down for that, too, just seeing how much Vince had into this guy. So, yeah, that would have been cool.
Might not have been pretty, but it would have been cool.
Oh, good heavens, no. But neither was Giant Gonzalez.
Exactly.
We got that at WrestleMania, too. So, or else we got A-Train and Big Show. So, you know, they're not all pretty.
No. Some of these are not going to be pretty. So, but they would have been interesting. They would have been unique and memorable.
Yeah.
So, who else do you have from those, you know, early days, maybe even a little bit pre-Undertaker, right around those beginning days?
I got somebody who I cannot believe that, like, well, it blew my mind that this has never happened. Mr. Perfect.
Okay. Yeah.
That, like, just the way, even in those old days, because we got to see Taker work against these smaller-ish guys later and the matches with Brett. Brett has gone on record saying those are his favorite matches, like, those with Taker. And so, you know, seeing a guy like Mr. Perfect who's just so seamless and who can sell, like, nobody's business, like, seeing that in the ring. And just the vignettes. Imagine the vignettes that, like, Mr. Perfect could have done, you know, against Taker. Like, I'm picturing the vignettes, you know, of that stuff. And just him being so cocky and arrogant going against somebody who at this time would have had, like, a perfect record in the ring, you know, like The Undertaker. So that would have been fun.
Nobody in the world ever has sold as well as Kurt Angle has. And just imagine him bumping off of Undertaker's uppercuts and choke slams and tombstones and doing, you know, 360s off of his clotheslines and everything. Yeah, exactly. Man, that could have been really, really cool. That was not one I had thought of, but
really,
I'm very shocked. That's perfect, though. That's a great idea. That's what this is all about.
You know, Slick Rick, up to this time, nobody's been able to hurt the Undertaker. Nobody's been able to beat the Undertaker, but Undertaker, you've never had to deal with a man with this much talent.
Here's one I was talking to you earlier. Technically, not really possible, but it did sort of happen before Undertaker was in WWE. As a guy he faced.
I think I know where you're headed here.
Yeah, a guy he faced in his Mark Callis days or Big Red, Texas Red, and there's some footage of it on YouTube and everything, but this is a guy that never made it to WWE, period, but it's a guy Undertaker obviously studied, obviously was influenced by, Bruiser Brody. Like,
yeah.
You could do a ton of dream matches of his in WWE, and he's somebody that, I mean, not till recently have I really, I always knew who he was, but I haven't really till recently watched a lot of his stuff, but man, like, yeah, him and his peak and Undertaker in his peak, like, not even 90s Undertaker, but if somebody you could bring in, like, you know, 2007 Undertaker with 1987 Bruiser Brody, man, how wild and crazy could that have been?
That would have been great. And again, who's going to sell in that match? Because like, they both, I mean, it would have been, hopefully it would have been more fun than, like, Goldberg Lesnar, you know what I'm saying? But, like, it would have been, I would have loved to have seen that. And I had that on my list. I struck it off because I didn't know if it was feasible or not. So I'm glad we're talking about it, because I do really like that idea, because that would have been really cool to have seen, you know, in the WWE, you know. Or, you know, they used to, you know, he had a, if he got sent to Japan for, like, I don't know, or his early years, like when WWE, like just that'd have been fun of seeing him go one on one with Brody over there. So.
And I'm sure he could have learned a ton just being in the ring. I know he was in the ring with him, you know, in his very early days. But, man, just spending time with him on the road could have done so much.
And once
he
had this character, too, like that would have helped, too. Because Brody didn't have this, but he had a character, you know. And I think it was just him, but, like, he had a character in the ring. So,
well, I'll say another one that kind of goes down that same road would be Abdullah the Butcher. Man, like, another guy who, you know, it ain't five-star wrestling, but... Just think of, like, him being in there and Undertaker brawling through the crowd. And, I mean, that guy would do literally anything. He's just absolutely insane. They could have had some freak shows, man.
They could have, man.
Could have taken it to another level.
They definitely could have, man. That would have been fun. And, even, you know, later on in his career, maybe when the Biker Taker era, if Abby could still go, bringing in the fork and all that stuff and just watch Taker go defend the hardcore title against him.
Well, I could see him, you know, doing the Kamala thing and just like with his facial expressions and Undertaker putting him in a casket and
that would've
been fun. Taking some crazy bumps into a casket or something like that. That could have been something else.
That could have been. That would have been fun. That would have been a lot of fun. So... Well, that's going to bring me to another one, and, you know, I have no idea how we didn't get this, but I'm going to say Roddy Piper.
Ooh, yes.
I would have loved to have seen that. Again, this wouldn't have even – it wouldn't have been a five-star classic. None, a lot of these early ones wouldn't have been there. That's not what Taker's character was back then. He wasn't putting on matches like he did with Shawn at WrestleMania. But just to have seen, again, the promos.
The promos.
The Piper's Pits versus the funeral parlors, like that would have been a blast to have watched those play out on Superstars or Wrestling Challenge or whatever it was. Like to see that, to see Paul Bearer go, you know, toe to toe on the mic with Roddy, and just Roddy is crazy, man. Like this, and he could sell that fear of Taker too, you know, like in the ring. So that would have been a lot of fun.
That would have been all about the promos. You're right. You know, it kind of reminds me of Jake the Snake's promos with Undertaker. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Piper and Jake the Snake kind of cut from the same cloth.
Sure.
In my opinion. So, yeah, it would have just been another layer to that. And that would have been interesting because, like, Piper never lost. Like, he probably lost, like, five, 10 times in his career ever. And like a few of those were in like the more recent years right before he died, like when he was in his 50s. But he never lost back then. He never laid down for anybody. It was always, if he ever lost, it was by like count out or DQ or anything. But I wonder if he would have put Taker over. Like
you gotta bet he would.
I would think he would have. You know, he would have respected that character, and that would have been the kind of guy that he would want to put over and lay down for. But either, you know, he would have got his stuff in with some promos and just been bonkers, off the wall. Been so good.
Oh yeah, it'd have been, and he could have played that scared stuff too. You know, with the urn and all that. It'd have been phenomenal. Yeah, you know?
Him and Paul Bearer going back and forth.
Oh yeah, awesome. So.
Well, let's just say, and another guy in that same vein, and this is a guy I think some of our listeners brought up, the Macho Man, Randy Savage, dude. Like, how did that not happen?
How did that not happen at all? I have no idea. I had to like go back and check and make sure I wasn't crazy, but like, how did that not happen, dude?
So they had a couple matches on some house shows, and I think one TV taping, but it's like never even been fully released, that match, I don't think.
Yeah.
So it's just, the promos. The promos Macho Man could have cut on Taker and, you know, on Paul Bearer, and seeing Macho Man in the funeral parlor. Just makes your imagination run wild. But again, his selling for Macho Man, another guy who could sell so well and would have just done so much to boost up that Undertaker character.
And he could have dropped the flying elbow, and then Taker sits up immediately after. You know, stuff like that. And just imagine the storyline they could have brought in with Liz, you know?
Well, they started Taker, to. Like,
yeah,
at Macho and Liz's wedding. And, you know, Taker was there with Jake the Snake, but they never quite got to doing Taker and Savage. Because Taker turned, Undertaker turned babyface pretty much through that.
Exactly.
Oh, a match made in heaven. A reception made in heaven. Wasn't it wonderful? All the dancing, all the champagne, the music, the presents. It was so wonderful. It almost brought a tear to my eye like a funeral. Oh, yes. But you know, there's a dent in my sacred vessel. There's a dent right there. And there's also a dent to match in Randy Savage's head. Oh, yes, I want to see it, please.
So, but just, yeah, that would have been, and then it could have been after he won the title from Hogan and lost it 6 days later. It could have been, you held the title for a cup of coffee. That would have been great, man. Would have loved that.
You know, if they were doing 12, 13, 14 pay-per-views a year back then, that would have happened. And a lot of these would have happened because... Yeah, they would have had to. That's part of the problem with these early days is that it was all squash matches on TV, and then you only had 3, 4, 5 pay-per-views a year. So a lot of these dream matches just kind of fell through the cracks.
Right. And again, like they, like you said, they've had some of these matches on TV, but we're talking about pay-per-view storyline, pay-per-view quality matches and stuff. And so, I'm glad you said that because he was on my list as well. And kind of in that same vein, a guy that Taker feuded with on Superstars, and we kind of touched on it on here, but they never had a pay-per-view match, is the Ultimate Warrior.
Ooh, okay, okay.
How I would have loved that. You talk about, we talked in the early episodes of this, how about, you know, comic books come to life, superheroes come, that's what wrestling was when we were kids, you know, like, nobody was a bigger, like, action hero come to life than Hulk Hogan and Ultimate Warrior. And then you got Taker there, who's like the villain of an action, you know, like, movie or comic book, like I would have loved to have seen them at a pay-per-view because they had a storyline on Superstars. You know, you talk about watching those old episodes and all that stuff, and I just thought that should have led to a pay-per-view. It would have been great. I would have loved to have seen that. I mean, it could have been a count out, like it doesn't matter what, but just have, what a missed opportunity to have seen those two guys go one-on-one on pay-per-view.
As I lay physically in that casket, but stand on the outside spiritually, reaching out, reaching through people that are right before me. I lay inside wondering if the warriors that speak to me, do they want in? Do they want out? Do they want to go to the place I am headed? I think, Undertaker, they want to travel as far as I shall go. With you, Undertaker, I shall travel into the darkness.
Exactly. You know, again, that's another one lost to the era because there just weren't as many pay-per-views and just wasn't a chance to do it. But yeah, man, it could have gone down in history, would have been legendary, a casket match, a body bag match, whatever you want to do back then. And, you know, just thinking about more promos, just the insanity that those guys would have had. And like I said, we know those guys did do some stuff together, but it wasn't on pay-per-view, and you know, we chart every pay-per-view match, so we're just kind of dreaming about that.
Can you imagine those promos with Warrior and just talking about, oh man, he would have gone on for days. Just, oh, it'd been awesome.
He could have risen from the dead and come back like all black or like
black and white paint on his face, something crazy like that. Nuts, yeah. Purple tassels hanging, or he would have had purple tassels. Yeah,
burst out of the grave. Something, I don't know, man. He would have done something insane.
It'd have been crazy.
Well, I guess this is kind of that same era. I'm moving forward a little slightly, but a guy that, I don't know if you had this one, but a unique character, somebody who didn't really live up to their potential, I think they could have had, but still made an impact. Doink the Clown. Heel Doink.
Yes. Okay, I didn't write that down, but in my head, like, that was the last one I was going to type out. Was like, what, like, talking about characters, man, that would have been so fun to have watched. Like you say, heel Doink and babyface Taker, that would have been so, and just the vignettes again, man. Exactly. Like, that would have been a blast.
It would have been money, man.
Oh yeah,
the creepy evil clown, you know. Mm-hmm. And him doing mind games, having multiple Doinks hiding, yeah, under the ring doing stuff up against Taker's mind games, and mm-hmm, Taker disappearing and reappearing and doing stuff with Paul Bearer, Doink playing tricks on him. You know, maybe they didn't do that because they didn't want to have anybody getting the best of Undertaker during that time. Maybe, I don't know, yeah, that, because nobody really got over on him
right
during that era, so maybe that's why they avoided that. But man, heel Doink was so great for such a short period of time. Mm-hmm. And there was so much more meat on the bone you could have done with that, and a match with Taker would have been really, really fun, in my opinion.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well, again, this is going kind of that same era there, and this is a guy who, again, cannot believe they never met on pay-per-view at this point, but they never did, but, you know, this is Scott Hall, Razor Ramon.
Okay,
like,
yeah,
I would have
yeah.
loved to have seen Razor and Taker have gone at it. They could have, it doesn't matter who was which role, babyface or heel, I think they would have been fun, and seeing him flick the toothpick at Taker or something, that would have just been just cool, you know, like to have seen that. And I don't know, it wouldn't have been a five-star classic, not because Razor can't do it, but because Taker's character at the time, again, wasn't about that. But just to have seen them interact and to have had that match, I would have really have loved to have seen that. So
I think that would have been an interesting way to turn Razor heel again. Mm-hmm. Like, maybe you do it in 95 or 96, yeah, after Razor's been baby, and try to do it as started out as babyface, and sure, then like Razor, you know, slowly brings sort of those heel aspects back in, and like,
because he can't beat him, yeah,
yeah, something like that. And I'm just picturing Razor throwing that toothpick, yeah, at Undertaker, and Taker no selling it or catching it or something like that. I don't know, like, there's a or you know, even Razor taking a page out of Kama's book and trying to melt the urn down for some more gold. To put around gold his neck. That great. Works way better for Razor Ramon than it does for Kama. Exactly. It doesn't make any sense for Kama. He didn't have any gold. It makes exactly. perfect sense for Razor. Oh, man. Now I'm mad.
He could have been riding around like Joe Dirt, like with the urn in his car, like driving down the streets of Miami, like with the urn, like just steal it.
What if he stole the hearse and like made it a convertible, yes, or something like that, exactly, man? Oh my God.
That's been great.
Come on.
So, yeah, that's a missed opportunity, man. I don't know why.
That's one of my favorites we've had so far.
Yeah, so
I
love good.
It. I can see it all in my head.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
Well, here's one that sort of in the same line as Doink. This might have been one that you were saying earlier. It's a guy Taker did face on pay-per-view, but not in this incarnation. And it's another one you just look back and you're like, I feel like it was supposed to happen. Something happened to change things up. But I'm talking about our good friend of the podcast, Charles Wright, a.k.a. The Godfather. But I'm talking about Papa Shango, man. Like, the voodoo master with the skull face paint and the smoke and poisoning people. How did that character not face The Undertaker on pay-per-view? What are we doing? What's the point?
I have no idea. That doesn't make any sense. I really can't wrap my mind around that one, for sure. Like, some of the other ones I get, but, like, that one doesn't make any sense to me. Especially because they were friends.
Yes, that too. Yeah.
You know, even at that point they were. So yeah, I don't know how that didn't happen. Like you said, we did have it in the later incarnation, but we'll count that because it's a totally different character.
Undertaker! You are not above approach! You devil in the spirits! You know nothing about this!
Yeah, that would have been great to have seen it again. We're talking about this era. It's all about the vignettes. And
it writes itself,
TV.
Dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, who's the real dead man, you know? Like, it could have been, it's so much meat on the bone there to have chewed on.
And, you know,
we didn't get it.
Allegedly, he was supposed to come back in the Attitude Era. Like, he was about to come back as Papa Shango, and then, like, the day before, they're like, no, you'll just be Kama in the Nation of Domination. So, like, just picturing Vince Russo writing a Papa Shango Undertaker feud. You got Kane in there, evil Paul Bearer. Like, whoa, man, that could have gone off the rails.
Absolutely. That'd have been bonkers, man. Whoa. Crazy. I mean, Taker could have stolen the little shrunken heads and all that kind of. It could have gone both ways. Like, anyway, he could have turned Papa Shango into Kama. It could have melted. He could have defeated him and put him in the grave. Yeah. So, a lot of stuff there. But kind of in the same vein with the character wise, I got a guy who, again, we saw Taker face this guy's cronies. But this is the man responsible for bringing Taker in, Ted DiBiase.
Yes.
Why did he never get a match with Ted? Like, he got all of his, you know, the guys underneath him, you know, your favorite, you know, IRS and all that stuff. Like, we got all those things, but we never got a Ted DiBiase. Like, to my opinion, that was the blow off match. And I know Ted wasn't really wrestling, but he could have come in and taken a few bumps or something, or took, you know, done a casket match where he just has to roll in it, or, you know, it would have been, but that to me would have just sealed the deal that Taker has beaten the final boss, you know?
Absolutely. Or, you know, even you could even do it before Ted retired, and maybe that's why he goes out and makes this whole $1 million corporation.
Sure.
Like, to get his revenge, because Undertaker retired him, you know, instead of, I think he lost to Razor Ramon at SummerSlam, and then he was he went over to Japan for a little while.
Yeah.
But yeah, like that, and they weren't afraid to play into that Undertaker Ted DiBiase. They mentioned it, you know, they mentioned that he was the guy that brought him in, even back then in those early days.
Mm-hmm.
So, man, that is, I didn't think about that, but yeah, that was just an obvious missed opportunity, man, to play into that history.
Yeah, I thought it was just so obvious. Like, why did we not get that? Like, I had to go back and remember, like, double check and make sure that they never wrestled on pay-per-view, because, you know, it seems so obvious, like you said. So,
yeah,
anyway.
So that's what so many of these are. But,
yeah.
Well, I don't really have anything else for that era of WWE. Like, some of my other WWE stuff is kind of going more towards Attitude Era and beyond, or, well, we're on the 2000s. What else do you have for this?
I got a Ricky Steamboat, just to have seen them go at it again, just because the matches that Taker would have been able to have had with a smaller guy like that, especially technician like Ricky. Again, I don't really know the storyline. That's just me dreaming up what would happen in the ring, you know? So I thought that'd be cool. And then a guy who kind of straddles this earlier era and goes into the mid to late 90s too, but Bam Bam.
Yeah, that's like, a big one. That's a big one.
What? Why was that? And why was that? Not, that's, to me, that's just, you know, battle of two big guys like that, you know? And it could have, I don't know. There's so many opportunities to have had that. And Taker, you know, he had Vader and stuff, and Yokozuna, he worked with big guys, and Kamala, but he never got to work Bam Bam on pay-per-view, so.
Yeah, we talked about him on one of those Coliseum videos that we did, and I think we said the same thing during that, man. Like, Bam Bam, just one of those guys, I don't know if he'll ever be in the Hall of Fame, but, like, he's just a guy that you remember him. Man, he jumped off the screen with his look. Who else do you ever know who had his skull tattoo?
Exactly.
But he could work too, and he like did moonsaults and did diving headbutts and did cartwheels, and I mean, he could go. And seeing him and Undertaker go, you know, for 15-20 minutes could have been so much fun.
Yep, that'd have been fun. So that about does it for those early 90s times for me. I got another guy who kind of straddles the early and the mids 90s, so I'll say that for our next little era here.
Well, let's drive over and do something totally different. You know, all of those matches certainly could have happened with just a slight tweak of plans or a slight flutter of the butterfly's wings, if you will. To quote my favorite Ashton Kutcher movie.
What's mine say?
Well, let's go to something totally out there.
Your tattoo say sweet.
Let's imagine the world where, man, the Undertaker gimmick, it's not quite working in WWE. He calls up Eric Bischoff. He calls up Ted Turner and heads over to WCW in the 90s. And, yes, we'll get to the obvious one in just a minute. But let's talk about some of the other WCW guys that he could have faced off with. One of mine on my list is, we saw him wrestle Ric Flair a few times on pay-per-view. We saw this man come in and hit the greatest spinebuster of all time at WrestleMania 18. What about a full-on pay-per-view match with Double A, the enforcer, Arn Anderson?
That would have been fantastic. I would have loved to have seen that. You know, like you said, we got to see him interact at WrestleMania X18. But, yeah, I would have loved to have seen that. I was trying to wrap my head around the story, you know, but I don't really know what you do. But, I mean, just, you know, could have had him versus the Horseman just as a singles match. Like, whatever. Yeah. Like, that would have been fun. But, yeah, seeing them get to go at it would have been awesome. You know, I would have loved that.
So. Yeah, maybe he's making his way through the Four Horsemen to get to Ric Flair, and Arn Anderson's the last stumbling block right there. But, man, just what a phenomenal worker. He would have found some creative ways to work with that dead man gimmick, and man, just would have been fun to see.
Look at me, Arn. Look at this hand. Oh, Arn Anderson, Ric Flair's best friend. That's as good as it gets for you. And it don't get any better than that. Arn Anderson is Ric Flair's best friend. The Undertaker wore the fight for WrestleMania. Flair said no. And this is what Flair's best friend gets. Arn Anderson getting beaten like a government mule. And Anderson is bleeding. I mean, he has been busted wide open by the Undertaker.
It definitely would have been. So, man, I'll tell you what. I don't have a lot of guys from WCW that didn't make their way to WWE later on. And so, but one guy who kind of straddles the WCW and Japan line there is Great Muta. Yes. I would have loved to have seen that. And it could have been WCW. I don't care. Or if he flies over to Japan, whatever. Like, Muta and Taker would have just been just the theatricality of it. Again, it may not have been a five-star classic, but that's not what it's about, you know. Look at Rock and Hogan. It was one of the greatest matches of all time, but it's not a five-star classic because you don't need that. I'm not saying this match would have been that, but it would have been so theatrical, so entertaining, so sports entertainment-y. It would have been fun, you know, to have seen. And, again, the mind games and the stuff they would have been able to do back and forth would have been really, really cool.
Oh, for sure. The entrances, the stare downs, the mist, and, you know, Undertaker does, we've seen him enjoy working with guys that Muta inspired through the years.
Yeah.
He had fun working with Tajiri, and Tajiri blew the mist in Taker's face and all of that. So I think he would have been game to do something like that with a legend like that. And that's just a guy, how did he never have a single match in WWE? Like, how did that never happen? It's just insane.
I don't know. Yeah, it
one
is.
Of the greatest.
Because even like Liger came into NXT that one night, so like it counts, you know. But like Muta never did, so I don't get it.
Well, let's talk about that guy. There's another guy, WCW/Japan. We mentioned him, I think, when he retired earlier this year, last year. I can't remember what it was.
January, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jushin Thunder Liger, a guy who, you know, he would randomly show up in WCW, be on some pay-per-views. He was never, like, officially really there, but he would just kind of pop up and just always tear the house down whoever he was
first
having
match
a match
on Nitro,
against.
Right?
Yeah, first one against Brian Pillman. Just, again, imagining the sort of stuff and the theatricality he could have done with The Undertaker. He was a guy that was not just a guy who did flips and dives and stuff. I mean, he was a worker. He could perform. He could tell a story. And him doing that bringing that flash and that spectacle against the aura and the presence of The Undertaker could have been something special.
Yep, absolutely. That's my sentiments exactly, and I had him written down as well. So that would have been fun. So,
well, let me say another guy before we get to the main WCW guy, and this guy you could kind of straddle with WWE as well. But to me, I associate him with WCW. I wouldn't argue if you associate him with WWE or even ECW. But again, maybe doing that Four Horsemen, working his way through there. What about the Loose Cannon, Bryan Pillman? Sort of towards in that era when he's the heel, when he's off the rails, and maybe he starts shooting on the Undertaker, on Mark Calloway. Maybe they could have integrated a little bit of that stuff in there towards the earlier days. And again, you could do that in ECW, you could do that in WWE as well. But I don't know, just thought that could have been something a little bit different.
That hadn't even crossed my mind, but yeah, like you said, once he kind of became that Loose Cannon-ish character, that would have been fun to have seen the like I said, again, we keep coming back to the promos. Like it, that would have been good. And it would have been a good match because he knew how to work, too. He knew how to bump for a big guy like Taker. So that would have been fun. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Well, why don't you talk about who I know it's one of the main guys that's always come up when you talk about Undertaker dream matches. And, I mean, I always thought of him as your favorite guy or one of your favorite guys.
Yeah.
One of your number one
this
of
is,
all time.
This is the guy that got me into wrestling. I mean, the second I saw him, I was hooked, you know, from his character. And then when he took a change of character later on, which is when I got back into wrestling, and that's Sting, you know. I really probably wouldn't have wanted to see Blonde Surfer Sting against Taker, but seeing the Crow, I'm just picturing those vignettes from Starrcade 97 and Sting in the rain and flipping his hair back and the stuff with the vulture on his arm, like just all that. The way he just rappelled down, you know, Taker did it at what, Survivor Series 96, like a month or two before Sting ever did. So wait, I remember touching on that here, but that's the big one. And, you know, allegedly they may have done it in 2002 at that WrestleMania, and allegedly they were going to try to do it again. And who knows? And we'll get to that later on in this, you know, talking Taker when I think what's that one year that Triple H comes back, I think it is, where everybody tells me Sting or whatever. So
yeah.
But that's the one, you know, Sting and The Undertaker. Again, two icons of their company, two guys that never wavered, never left, were, you know, obviously Sting left once, you know, came to WWE eventually, but like at the time, during the wars, during the, you know, in the trenches, he was the guy, you know, the backbone of that company, and Taker was on the other side. So they were just, you know, mirror images, you know, of each other for their company. So that's a dead ringer for this.
There is no way the Stinger's going to get tombstoned by the Taker. That ain't happening. Not on my watch. What would have happened is a few Stinger splashes.
In the corner! Stinger splash!
Death drop. And probably the death lock.
Scorpion death lock! Get him in it now!
Oh, yes, yes, please! Yes, please! Who was king of that throughout the Monday Night Wars? Who was king of that with WCW?
Sting!
Mwah. Stinger here. I need a guy.
Well, I know there's some people out there that don't see it. I know Randy Turco, he always comments whenever we talk about Undertaker and Sting, is like he just never really kind of craved that match. But man, I know I sure did. Always have through the years. And it is kind of the one that got away. Really,
yeah.
That's the main one at the top of everybody's list. They both, even, you know, even if their characters didn't always parallel, just their status and their respective
yes.
companies during the Monday Night War, they were the two cornerstones of their different companies, their different brands, whatever you want to call them back then, different federations. And man, so many different opportunities this could have happened. 2002, 2011, just anywhere in between. Everyone always thought maybe this will be the year. This will be the year they bring Sting in. Maybe this will be the year they do that match. And Sting finally comes over in 2014, and you just assume that's got to be it, man. That's got to be what they're bringing him in for. And he faces Triple H, and it's like, okay, you know, that was fun. It was, you know, some
nostalgic.
People don't like that match. I think it's pretty fun. I'm cool with it. Goes on to face Seth Rollins, which is cool, but unfortunately, it basically ends Sting's career. Yeah, maybe that could have been WrestleMania 32 instead of Bray Wyatt, had Sting stayed healthy and been able to do that. Maybe that could have been in the works.
Yeah, that would have been fun. So I would have loved to have seen that for sure. So, you know, like I said, it is the one that got away, and it'll always have gotten away. It's never going to be able to be obtained. I don't see Sting ever being able to wrestle again. And Taker, you know, like you said, he's probably done. We kind of hope he's done because he's gone out in a good way. But, yeah, that's the one in WCW that stands out as the higher above everything. So would have been really cool.
I think Sting still craves it. You know, he still will tweet about it and tease it a little bit. And maybe that's part of it, too. I don't get the idea that Undertaker wanted it as badly as Sting right. wanted it, or as bad as a lot of the fans wanted it. For some reason, he's just, you know, never given off that vibe. He doesn't talk about it in interviews. It's not one of those things that comes up. Maybe I'm totally wrong, but I think that may have had something to do with it through all these years. If he really wanted it to happen, I think Undertaker could have made it happen and could have made a call. I could have made one call to Steve and been like, let's do this thing. And he would have been like, sorry, Dixie. Peace out.
Exactly. Yeah. So, but anyway, that's, you know, that's the holy grail of missed Taker matches, in my opinion. Like, that's it right there.
I do think if there's ever any chance, you could do something cinematic, do it like a Boneyard match. Now that they've proven there's a way to do that, maybe now there's a chance you could still, sliver of a hope, you could do something like that. But I doubt it. I mean, when do you think would have been like the ideal time to have these
I would have loved, honestly, even though it would have been, I mean, ideally 98, but like they're in opposite companies. But if you say if it's actually a feasible time, WrestleMania 18, I would have loved to. That had been after the invasion. Sting could have, if Sting was part of the invasion, that would have been, that would have helped tremendously, but he wasn't. But even say we get after that, when Ric Flair comes back in November of 2001, he brings Sting in because he started that feud with Taker and Vince and stuff at the beginning of 2002. Like, have him have Sting as his proxy and face Taker at WrestleMania 18. That would have been fun. It would have been Biker Taker, I know, but it would have been, I'm thinking of an actual feasible time that Sting would have been available and Taker was available too. So that's what I think.
Dude, yeah.
As far as realistically.
Think about the invasion going smoother. You're able to bring in your Stings, your Goldbergs, your Hall and Nash, your Hogan earlier on. Maybe WrestleMania 18 is the culmination of the invasion angle, and maybe you've got some of these matches that you haven't done. You've saved them until this point. Maybe you've got Undertaker Sting, you've got Rockin' Hogan, you've got Austin Goldberg, you know, just like the culmination. Everything's on the line. Oh, man, could have been. What could have been? That's what we're talking about.
That's what WrestleMania could have been. To 18 should have been. Yeah, all those dream matches on one big night, you know. So, but it wasn't, and, you know, there's no sense in harping on it because it's over.
Well, that's what we're doing. That's what we're here for.
Oh, no, I mean, like, some people want to talk about, oh, the invasion should have gone. But it gets over, though. Guys, like, it's been 19 years. Like, it's over. Like, it doesn't matter what it should have been. It's gone, so.
Well, where do you want to go next, man? Where you want to go to sort of later 90s, Attitude Era, Ruthless Aggression, WWE. You want to go over to ECW, TNA? Let's go to ECW. Okay, who you got?
All right, well, and we mentioned this guy on here before, Sabu. Come on. And here you go. I got the perfect game plan here. Okay, 97, getting barely legal off the ground. Obviously, we know now that Paul Heyman is in Vince's back pocket. He's, you know, helping fund the thing. They have him on Raw. You have the quote-unquote invasion, the first invasion in ECW. Have one of those exhibition matches be, you know, ECW rules match between Sabu and Taker right there. It was no harm in that. Sabu doesn't have to lose, like, clean. He could have gone chokeslam through a table, and then that's it. Tables match kind of thing. Like, it doesn't have to be, but, like, just seeing those guys go on. I mean, obviously, I prefer to have seen it in, like, Biker Taker era when Sabu was still there and it was actually in the company and Taker I guess he wasn't Biker Taker at that point, was he?
Yeah, he was dead.
And just, well, but anyway, it would have been cool to have seen them. But I was thinking 97-ish when ECW and WWE are working together and you get to see it on screen, that would have been fun.
Dude, I mean, come on. It's another one that a lot of you listeners out there have brought up as well. And just the more you think about it, just the wild stuff Sabu could have done, diving off of, you know, who knows this, that, whatever, and Undertaker catching him, Undertaker doing a dive to match him, something like that. And I'm thinking just like that 97 Undertaker when he's really starting to break out and to do more stuff like that. And that's like kind of where Sabu was at his best, really. Could have been one for the ages.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What about you? You got somebody from ECW?
I'll say a guy I could have thrown him in WCW, or I could throw him in WWE in this era too. You know, he's so many different eras. How about Terry Funk, man? Just the middle-aged and crazy Terry Funk, just doing moonsaults, taking whatever bump. He might have gotten thrown off Hell in a Cell. He might have been willing to do that. Who knows, man? I know.
Yeah, chokes
him out of his shoes. Yeah, maybe he gets some revenge for that. Taking chair shots, dishing out chair shots. I don't know, man. I think Taker would have loved to do something like that.
He could have brought Chainsaw Charlie out after that Hell in a Cell, and you know, been like revenge for his friend,
Cut
Mankind.
Cut his way in there.
I didn't have him on my radar, like honestly, at all. To me, that's such a Styles. I couldn't think of a storyline, but that makes sense now. After the Cell and King of the Ring, that could have been the next, you know, the next month's pay per view. Well, Taker had a busted ankle, but other than that, you know, like that would have been a nice little one off. So.
Yeah.
And yeah, he'd gone above and beyond to do some craziness. So.
Oh my goodness, no doubt about it.
Well, here's another guy, and I'm going to put this one down. And this is just, when I say this guy can't wrestle a lick, but he has got the presentation of all presentations when it comes to ECW. And imagine the entrances for this match. You've got the Sandman and the Undertaker.
Yes.
Come on, man. And you could have done this in, say, 97 again when they're invading or whatever. Or you could do this with Biker Taker. You could have Biker Taker and Sandman. The kind of same kind of, you know, one's a dip-spitting, you know, like redneck
heel.
From Texas.
Heel Biker Taker.
One is, yeah, oh, yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, big evil.
And Sandman is the, you know, he's Sandman. And, like, that has just been seeing those entrances on the motorcycle and then Sandman coming to the crowd. And then just, again, it would have been a train wreck of a match. We don't care, though. That would have been a wonderful presentation and a really cool moment on pay-per-view to have seen these two guys go.
Yeah, I didn't list that one, but yeah, man,
really?
Absolutely.
I'm shocked.
No, that's great, though. I love thinking about that. And yeah, like that heel Biker Tigger and he takes some kendo stick shots to the head.
Oh, yeah.
Gets some color, but ends up, you know, choke slamming Sandman off the stage through some tables or something like that. Sort of like the RVD Undertaker match from Vengeance 01, which is one of my favorites, man. Yep. I could see something along those same lines.
But I wrote it down. I wrote literally in parentheses, wrote entrances alone, but that would sell me on it. Like,
well,
that's all I got.
That's half of ECW right there.
Yeah.
I'll say another one. I didn't write it down, but I'm just thinking it now. How about New Jack, man? How about New Jack making his entrance?
No,
how about him diving off a balcony on the Undertaker? How about him calling the Undertaker the White Savior?
Oh, yikes,
pull some fruit, Nation of Domination.
That would have been terrible. He might go...
New Jack did kill a guy, so he could go up against
Undertaker. Yeah, I mean, I would not have. You Taker would never have signed up for that. He would never have said okay.
Did he face him in Smoky Mountain?
Yeah, they did. Ooh, yeah.
All right, Undertaker, Paul Bearer, Cornette. This is about as low as you can get. Speaking of low, we probably stand on a grade that's about 6 or 7 foot deep, but this is about as low as you can get. Now I'm going to show you that the gangsters ain't scared. I'm going to show you that we going to stoop to your kind of match. You understand? You wanted the gangsters, now you got the gangsters. And I don't like being out here. I'm going to be honest. I really don't. But we going to come, and we going to try to get rid of Undertaker, Paul Bearer, Cornette, and Tracy. You know what I mean? And I hope for the sake of everybody, this is the last time I have to walk through a graveyard. I don't like being out here, and I might...
Hey, what was that? I heard something, man.
What?
Over
you
there.
Ain't heard nothing.
I heard something,
up.
Man.
No, you did. You ain't heard nothing.
I told you I heard something.
Wait.
They did. Yeah, that was like a Confederate flag on a pole map or something like that. It was something awful. Not good.
Not great.
So, no. Well, and another guy here from ECW that we talked about on the podcast, and I think they had some interaction on a SmackDown episode, but that's Taz. You know, just Taz at his peak. 98, 99, with Undertaker, you know, just again the stature, as far as literally their literal height, it is glaring. It looks ridiculous next to each other. But like, Taz was a world beater, man. Like he was a pit bull. He just eats you alive, you know. And that was his whole thing, the FTW title and all that. Like, could have brought that over. And Taker's like, I'm not standing for that. I hope, you know. that title's disrespectful. Whatever. Like, that would have just been, it would have been fun to have seen, to me, the build up. And again, the match might have been bull and chew ugly, to quote JR, but like, I just, Taz was, he was it in ECW for a while, man. Man, he was the guy.
That's one, like, I'd like to see how they make it work. Cause in my head, I'm like, I don't know if you could, but I would like to see him try, just because of the size difference and the way those two characters are, the way you make the Taz character work. I think he'd have a tough time in there with Undertaker, but you know, they put some effort into it. Maybe have Undertaker be a bit of a heel in there, or, you know, I don't know. Definitely Taz in like 97, 98, not the WWE version of Taz yeah, that version of Taz. Would have been unique. Like I said, I'd like to see him try it.
Yep. You got any more ECW guys?
That's my ECW.
I got one more, but he straddles. I mean, he was in WWE as well when he was in WCW, but that's Mike Awesome. We talked about that on here.
Okay. Should have thought of that. Yeah.
I would have liked, to have seen that just as a pure two big guys going at it, two agile big guys that can walk the ropes, jump over the ropes, powerbomb each other, suplex each other. And I think even the 1999, 2000 Mike Awesome, like, that's, it didn't have to be, or it could have been when he was in, you know, the Invasion. I would have liked to have seen him been given a serious push as a singles competitor. We talked about that on our episodes earlier, the missed opportunity, but he was such a fantastic big guy, such agility. And apparently a really, like, sweet guy too, like, to get along with. But, you know, I just would have really liked to have seen what those two guys with a very similar style could have done in the ring.
Or how about the guy Mike Awesome used to face all the time, Masato Tanaka? I don't know if that's worth the pay-per-view match, but no. They could have had, they would have had a great match.
Yeah, it would have been something. It would have been something.
But yeah, dude, we loved Mike Awesome back in the day. Yeah. He was my world champ on the SmackDown video game. created, like, before, yeah. Like SmackDown 2, I think, had a created Mike Awesome, man. He was my long reigning champ on there. He was the man. His running power bomb, frog splash, big dives, yeah, would have been really fun. He wouldn't be the big man in there against Undertaker, so it'd be interesting how he adapts his style to do that. Be the smaller guy up against him.
Yeah, well, they could have had it'd be two big guys, but it'd have been a match similar to like a, you know, Shawn and Taker match, like, just as far as how agile, like, Mike Awesome could have played that role, you know. It's crazy because a big guy he was, but I think it would have been a fantastic thing. I think the crowd would be on their feet watching those guys go, honestly.
I definitely think they could have got him into it for sure.
Well,
let's take it back maybe more into the realm of realistic possibilities here, and maybe even some guys that Undertaker did face, because really once you get into Attitude Era, Ruthless Aggression Era, a lot of, you know, I don't have too many guys, honestly, because he had so many pay-per-view matches, but there are a couple glaring omissions, I think, and some of these are guys Undertaker did face, and even this one guy, he technically did face him on pay-per-view, but I still wish we could have got a singles match, wish we could have got so much more. I'm talking Latino Heat, Eddie Guerrero, dude, just doing some lying and cheating and stealing, and a heel Eddie Guerrero up against Undertaker stealing the motorcycle, or, you know, gimmicking it so it doesn't start or blows up on him. Man, just so many possibilities there. Even a babyface Eddie Guerrero with that heel Big Evil Undertaker, he could have had a lot of fun with him. And, you know, Undertaker, that's a guy, you know, Taker would have loved to get some more work with him. That's the perfect guy for Undertaker. Talk about working with smaller guys. I mean, that's just amazing.
You know, man, we're forgetting something. It's not about JBL tonight, man. We got a bigger obstacle.
What's that, man?
You forgot? El Hombre Muerto.
Who?
Undertaker!
What Bruce Pritchard calls in the Mexican Shawn Michaels, you know? And Shawn, when Taker's best matches, in my opinion, are the ones with Shawn. So imagine what they could have done. But yeah, I didn't write that down because technically they had that four-way, but I really wanted to because, yeah, I agree with you. A singles match between those two would have just been, I mean, off the walls. So good, man. We'd be talking about it today still just because how good it is.
Yeah, it could be in our top 10 or top 15, you know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, here's a guy who he... Okay, I'll go with the same kind of vein. A guy that he was in a tag team match against, but never had a singles match. That's X-Pac.
Oh, all right.
I would have loved to have seen, like, 1997 yes. or 8. Maybe 8 with DX. 1998, 99, X-Pac versus Taker. Like, man, we talked about... The tag match, it was X-Pac
yeah,
and Kane.
Yeah, I know. It was in your top 10.
Yeah, I loved it. And to have seen them go just one-on-one... Because you could have played it with the Ministry versus DX or whatever. It's so much storyline. Vince Russo could have found something for him, but I would have loved to have seen that, you know?
Wow, wow, wow. What do we have here, X-Punk? I suggest you stand back in the corner, little boy, because my Undertaker has a few words to say.
We said it with the bottom line guys, like, yeah, X-Pac, he, that's a real thing. Like, for some reason, 2001, 2002, X-Pac booed out of the most mm-hmm. boring, the worst, suckiest, crappiest guy on the yep. roster. 98, 99 X-Pac, he's like a top three dude in the company.
Oh, yeah.
Like, most over. Mm-hmm. Him as a babyface against, like, that heel Ministry of Darkness Undertaker. Mm-hmm. I think maybe had Taker not been hurt and maybe like gone through the end of 99, that
I think so too.
That definitely could have happened. We could have seen that match and it could have been really, really fun.
Yeah, that would have just been fun. You know, it would have been really, really, really fun. So, anyway.
This one, he doesn't really fit in with any other guy, any other group that I have on my list. This would be the closest thing, but it's jumping forward a few years. But Umaga. Like,
oh, yeah, I got him too.
Just another guy.
How?
Yeah, how? How did that not happen? How did we not get a reprisal of Undertaker Yokozuna with
yes.
Umaga? How did we not tell that story? How did we not do casket matches? We got yes. Mark Henry multiple times. Like I said, we got Big Show multiple times. Those matches
Umaga
suck. Can we just pivot over to Umaga and we could yeah. tell the same story? Like, imagine exactly. if yeah. Umaga was the guy that was knocking out Undertaker with the Samoan Spike instead of Big Show trying to get over that knockout punch for the millionth time.
Or Kali and the Chop. You know, imagine
oh
if that was Umaga's
spot. Oh, my God. Yes, yes.
And Alejandro cutting those promos on Taker and stuff. It would have been great, man. Like, that would have been awesome. So, yeah, I have him a little bit later on down my list there. But, yeah, I agree. That's one I would have loved to see on pay-per-view. So, another guy from rewinding it back a little bit before that is, you know, he faced this guy on pay-per-view, but never is this character. That's Cactus Jack. Are you kidding me?
Okay.
Are you kidding me? How did we not get that? Are you kidding me? Like, I would have loved, it could have been after 98 King of the Ring, Mankind comes back as Cactus Jack to, you know, avenge that or something. You know, they could have just done it for a month. I mean, because Mick was able to switch into that character on and off just, and it made storyline sense. You know, like we did with Triple H in 97. And in 2000, like, it was fine. It made sense. But I just thought Cactus and the character of Cactus Jack and The Undertaker would have been, I don't know why we didn't get that, man.
That's really interesting. I've never considered that. You know, Undertaker, his whole feud with Mick Foley is
always
about
Mankind.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
never
Dude always.
Love, which
nope.
You don't really want to see that, but
no, I didn't.
Man,
yeah.
that could have a bit. That could have added a new layer
yeah.
to that feud. You know, I've tried as man. I've tried to beat you.
Exactly.
You keep throwing me off. You throw me through the cell. You keep destroying me. I got to bring out something else. I got to bring out
yep.
the big guns to do Cactus
yep.
Jack. Oh man, I love that.
I mean, just lather, rinse, repeat the storyline from Triple H. You know, either in like I said in 97 or 2000. Just I got to bring this guy out to face you. You know, that would have been great. So anyway.
Well, I'll say another one that he did face multiple times, but never on pay-per-view. And it's somebody we have talked about a bunch. We love those matches. But Shelton Benjamin, man, just so, so good in the ring. Their TV matches were solid. And Undertaker, he sold for him. He worked with him for like 10, 15 minutes. He's taking German suplexes from him over and over again. Just what the heck, man? Like why... Why again, all these crappy people that he had pay-per-view matches with couldn't trade one of those for Shelton Benjamin? Shelton doesn't need to go over, but he could have got a rub for being in there with Taker.
They never went over on him. He could have done the same as that match they had on SmackDown, just on a pay-per-view, and just played it up as he could have got a fluke win over him on SmackDown or a count-out win, and you know they want to go to a pay-per-view and have a real settle the score thing. It would have been great, man. I thought that you would write that down. I didn't write down that. I knew we'd be discussing him tonight. in that same vein, honestly, as a guy who he had TV matches with and we loved, and it could have fit right into a storyline and been on pay-per-view, and that's Fit Finley.
Remember those matches? Yeah, man.
It's so good. But like,
he loved to fight.
He did, and like it would have fit in with any of that time, you know, with King Booker and all that stuff, or even after that, with just in 2007 and 2008, any time, and then they could have slid, you know, Finley in there, and I would have loved to have seen that as just a one-off, you know?
You know, they'd be just throwing haymakers, man.
Oh, yeah.
Potatoing each other, black eyes, just everything, man. That would have been that's the perfect kind of old-school guy. They could have, tore the house down, just an old-school brawl.
We just thought we'd come out and join the party, you know? I've got a new pair of boots to break in. I've got Hornswoggle. There's a giant leprechaun over there. I've got my shillelagh. So, I've come here to fight.
How about William Regal in that same vein, man?
Just
another guy. The facial expressions you could have got from him doing promos with Undertaker. Imagine him in a casket match and having to be afraid of the casket and sell that, or buried alive, or Inferno match, or something like that. And, William Regal never had a bad match. He worked with anybody, so he could have made it work with Taker.
Well, we'll find out what kind of ambassador William Regal is. Oh, no! The Undertaker! Wait a minute! Oh, the count! The last! The count! Is that finished? Yes, he is! Oh, my gosh! William Regal turned it on his way out of the last ride! But come on, man! Regal won it down, and the Undertaker...
You know, I think you talk funny.
Yep, I have that too, and I thought the same exact thing you just said, just as far as the facials and the reactions that he got from William Regal would have just put it over the top. So
he could have spread his legs out all the way across like he did when he took that tombstone that one time. You remember?
Yeah. I thought you meant with Paul Bear and
that's what his legs looked like.
Yeah. Here's a guy who we talked about, an epic match that they had, career defining match, but never had it on pay-per-view, and that's Jeff Hardy.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, I mean, sure. Just that ladder match is legendary, but imagine if they could have had that on pay-per-view or a rematch, just a cage match or something else, just to have really same outcome. Jeff doesn't win, can't win the big one against Taker, but Taker gives him that respect at the end. Like, that would have been really, really cool. And I'm thinking that era. I don't want Hardy, like, I don't want earlier Taker. I want this that character of Taker and Jeff Hardy on pay-per-view.
I will actually say I want we got a little tease of it in 2009.
Yeah.
One episode of SmackDown too, where Jeff Hardy's, you know, in the main event scene, and he's they have a match on, so it's like a no DQ match, and Jeff Hardy's just kind of off his rocker and he's got the face paint on, and we get a little promo between those two, and it's like, man, what might have been, you know, if they would have been able to go full bore and have, you know, 4, 6, 8 weeks to build up something like that, man.
They could have done it at the Royal Rumble, because we talked about how those pay-per-views don't really matter what's on there, because the Rumble sells itself. So they could have done saved that for Rumble and done those two again. It would have been great. Yeah, I didn't think about that. I was thinking more make Jeff Hardy earlier in his career, but that would have been probably even better is later on in his career. So once he was a main eventer.
Well, here's a guy that fits in that same category, and a guy who's linked to Jeff Hardy in a lot of ways, and somebody that Undertaker did face on pay-per-view, but only in tag matches, or a tag match, I think. I think it was even like a three-way tag match, but a guy faced Undertaker. He faced Undertaker a million times and took the best bumps from Undertaker. What about Christian? Like, once he's singles mode, peep show, heel Christian, even in, like, you can go deeper, like, 2009, 2010, 2011, that level Christian, once he's, like, established main event guy. Why not, man? Why do we never get that?
Exactly. I think by the time he was just the main eventer, Taker was not around, but once or twice a year, you know. But, yeah, I would have loved to have seen that, you know.
Mick, our point is, we just want to apologize and ask you to tell The Undertaker that we meant no disrespect. You know, he didn't get to where he is today by any fluke. You might say he earned it. Aces, dude.
I actually didn't write that one down. I thought we'd be talking about it, but I couldn't figure the storyline out to get to there. But, yeah, I would have loved to have seen that. It could have been even in his feud with Edge. Well, no, he wasn't back yet when Taker's feud with Edge. Yeah, after he came back to ECW, you know, in 2009, they could have done it somehow, some there. They didn't. The brands didn't matter, so they could have made it happen. So, but yeah, that would have been fun. He never got to have that Taker pay-per-view match. Edge got 1,000 of them and got the main event WrestleMania.
I know. So. I know. Poor Christian.
Yeah. Well, here's a guy who's also linked to Edge and Christian, and it's just Gangrel. We could have had that in 99, just on one of those random, you know, I think, you know, when they break out of the ministry or Taker kicks them out of the ministry or whatever it is, cause they just, like, they're gone. Like, they beat them up and send them on their way, but, like, that they could have developed that a little bit more, you know, and had Gangrel and Taker go at it. Their characters would have made perfect sense, and the storyline was right there. He was part of the ministry.
Seems so obvious.
Yeah, it's so obvious. It wouldn't have been a great match, but none of the matches were in 99, really, honestly. It was all about the story.
No.
And the drama.
A bloodbath match. Could have done an Inferno match. A Ring of Fire match. I mean, imagine Russo booking a Gangrel Undertaker match. Or you split off the Brood from the Ministry of Darkness and make them like this big babyface faction to go up against Taker. Put these young guys over. Man, missed opportunity. No doubt about it. I don't know. That's kind of what I've got for that era. Besides, we could throw this guy in as a guy who had. What do you got? What do you say?
Oh, go ahead.
No, you're smiling.
I think you're going to say what I'm going to say.
What am I going to say?
Are you thinking Tommy Dreamer with all the dip spit and all that stuff? That's not Imagine what I was that thinking. Little storyline. That would have been a pay per view. No. You don't want Tommy?
Sure, I'm down with it. That's just not what's on my list.
Oh, man, I thought you were going there.
I'm fine with it, yeah.
You know, all the just getting him back for abusing him with the hardcore title and making him drink dip spit and all that kind of stuff. They could have just played it off, come to a head at a pay-per-view. So.
No, I'd watch it. I'd pay my money. Just a guy we've talked about a bunch lately, but just never got that singles match. You know, the best in the world at what he does, Chris Jericho.
Absolutely.
And that, of course, comes where, you know, it's later on, 2009, 2010 era, where he's finally faced him on pay-per-view. But you could have done it anytime during his 11 years. 11 years, whatever, 20 years, whoever, however long his career is.
Yeah, they could have done it in 2000, in 99. Well, he cut Undertaker off. That's his second ever appearance on TV. Told Undertaker he did a dumb, boring promo, and that was it was a dumb, boring promo. He ripped him for.
Hey, boy. I don't know who you are or who you think you are, but judging from that peach fuzz you're trying to grow on your chin, I can tell I got more shower time than you've got ring time. And if you ever, and I mean ever, decide to interrupt me again, it will be your last time. And that is a promise.
Anyway, yeah, they could have done it earlier on in his career or, later on when they were both established and Jericho really was, you know, a six-time world champ and all that. That'd have been fun, so... That's an obvious WWE glaring omission. But I got another guy who fits in. He's a WCW guy, in my opinion, but he came over to WWE a couple stints. But I would have loved to have seen this guy against the Biker Taker. And that's big Papa Pump, Scott Steiner. Imagine, again, that just he just rambles on. He just talks. And they could have brought it in, the Biker Taker, just the heel Biker Taker, or even a babyface. I don't care. But, like, I really feel like they would have meshed well as far as on the mic, and just the storyline could have been, you know, it could have been there, you know, like he thinks he's everything, and Taker's like, no, I'm the big dog in the Shard, you know, you're the big Pop Pump, I'm the big dog, whatever it is, you know, I run the Shard. It could have been something simple like that, but I think that would have been fun. Again, the match would have blown in 2003 or 4 or 5 because Big Pop Pump couldn't go anymore, but I just thought it was a missed opportunity once he did come back to WWE that they never got that. But it may be because he blew it with Triple H.
On Twitter, at RedDragon0624 Dalton, this might have been my favorite Twitter reply, and we'll get to some more of them later on, but he said, me and my buddy were talking the other day about how much more entertaining it would have been if Scott Steiner was given the stalker angle instead of DDP. Can you imagine Big Papa Pump is trying to steal Undertaker's wife and trying to stalk her? Talking about being with the big bad booty daddy and being his freak. How much better does that work than DDP?
That would have been amazing. That would have been – there you go. That's what I'm talking about right there. That guy, that character, I didn't even think about that. Him being the stalker instead, that would have been phenomenal. That's amazing. That's so good. Yeah, he could have been just trashing. Oh, man, that would have been awesome. I can't even repeat the thing.
Give me a half and
Mike. He would have said, yeah. Could have done the math for us.
Seriously.
All this stuff.
And then there's so many to scroll through, but somebody brought up a Brothers of Destruction versus Steiner Brothers match.
Thank
and
you. I have that down later. Yeah.
Made me fall out of my seat. Yeah. Like 93-94 Steiner Brothers against 2001 Brothers of Destruction. Yeah. Are you serious? Someone would have died.
Take my money. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. It would have been awesome.
Suplex City.
Oh, yeah. That would have been so good, man. So good. I have that written down, too, so later on. But, yeah, that would have been fun, man. I like that as a stalker angle. That would have been a lot of fun. I got a couple more WWE guys. Well, one is... We talked about it, and he fits into WWE, but it's Raven, you know, as that original character, like not the WWE version of it. It could have been like the 2002 version when he comes back with the dreads and kind of got into more of that Raven character and started doing the Seven Deadly Sins thing. Like, that would have been fine, but like, I'm talking 97, 96,
Flock,
95.
I mean, Flock Raven against Ministry of Darkness, Undertaker, maybe. Something like that.
That would, again, it just writes itself, man. And just the promos would have been phenomenal. I mean, nobody in ECW is better on a mic than Raven was. I mean, he just, him and Tommy Dreamer are still one of my favorite storylines in wrestling history. Like, I just love that storyline. Again, Raven could go in the ring, but he didn't have to because he would take punishment. He'd give it out. He'd break you down mentally before you had to physically. So I just, you know, he's one of my favorites. I love the thought of them crossing paths at any point in their career, honestly, on pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That could have been something really unique. You know, this Raven, the Raven character is just one of the most unique things, really, in the history of wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think Pritchard and Vince McMahon, you know, a lot of those guys said they didn't really, or Bischoff, you know, Bischoff says he didn't
wrong with
get
that guy.
It. Yeah. But, God, it definitely clicked with people, and he's a guy when he's motivated.
The 10 like million people that bought every grunge album in the 90s, like, they all got it. Like, you kidding me? Like, all the kids at ECW got it. Like, Bischoff just didn't get it. And so, doesn't mean it's not right or it's not working, dude. Like, come on. And I got one more guy in the same vein, my boy Rhino. Think about 2001 Rhino when he was getting a big push in the invasion angle. He's sidelined, or he's, you know, side with Stephanie. He's feuding with, I guess he fights Jericho at SummerSlam, doesn't he? 01?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's right.
He's on the invasion, like, 5-on-5 thing. So I guess he technically got to face Taker, but I mean, a 1-on-1 match with these two, because in during that time period, you know, instead of maybe DDP or Chronic as a tag team, like, that would have been really, really fun, you know, I think.
He was so fun to watch during that period, and he was somebody mm-hmm. the WWE just never really knew exactly what to do with him. You know, Paul Heyman knew how to use him, and he ended up becoming world champion in TNA, which is where I'd like to take our conversation briefly. I don't have too many TNA guys
that are
like exclusively TNA guys. I've got I have three technically that I'll throw out there. So we probably have one crossover, one definite one.
Obvious one.
But I'll say Christopher Daniels, man, like. The fallen angel, Christopher Daniels, sort of that Ministry of Darkness guy, the greater power, the original idea, according to Vince Russo, maybe potentially could have been the greater power. But, man, just one of the most underrated guys in the history of pro wrestling because, you know, he never made it in WWE. You know, he's TNA, and I'm really glad he's on AEW now and getting that paycheck and a little bit of recognition here towards the end of his career. But just what a great performer. Definitely a smaller guy. Would have been tough, I think, to book that match. But could have done some really cool things with that.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I didn't even think about that character. I was thinking... that's perfect, man. That writes itself, you know. He could even bring in the realism of I was supposed to be the higher power. Break that wall down, you know, and say that you took my spot. It's supposed to be me, you know. That would have been kind of fun, too, to get that work shoot stuff in there. So, been a lot of fun. Go ahead with the other one, because I think the last one's the obvious one.
Okay, well, you could throw this guy into modern-day WWE, too. But for me, I'm thinking, like... peak TNA Samoa Joe against Undertaker, man.
I have him down for my WWE stuff later on. But yeah, I agree, man. That, 2006, 7, 8, Samoa Joe.
Yes.
Shoo, man. That'd have been great. I was going to think of 2008 Undertaker, that guy. 2009 Undertaker, what he did in the ring. Like, probably his best, like, in ring. Like, 2006 to 2010, like, that stuff is... phenomenal. That's where Joe was at his peak too, man. That'd have been phenomenal to see those guys go.
I think that could have been a WrestleMania quality match. Like, I'm thinking Undertaker Batista. Like, like what Samoa Joe could do at that time. You know, he's better than Batista, and I know they're not quite the same, but I'm just thinking sort of that same strong big man style. Mm-hmm. And Batista could do. I mean, Joe could do even more than Batista could. He could do some high flying stuff and just. You know, the creativity that those guys could have had, the intensity that they would have brought to the feud. And you could even do it now, you know. Samoa Joe's still good. You know, he slowed down a bit and older, more injuries. But, man, just could have been really fun. But
yeah, absolutely.
Of course, there's one major TNA match, the biggest TNA match that really stands out. And another one that was rumored to possibly be a WrestleMania match at one point.
Well, and it could happen if Taker were to come back, because this guy works for WWE, and he was actually on SmackDown last week, and I loved every second of it. We're talking about Joseph Park Esquire, Mr. Abyss himself.
Oh, man.
No, like, that is a TNA character. That, I mean, that he's the closest thing they had to a Taker or a Kane. You know what I mean? And a lot of people called him a ripoff of Kane or whatever. Like, dude, he made it his own. And, like, I saw the influence of Kane, obviously, but, like, you can't miss that. But, like, Kane was also influenced by, like, Michael Myers, and so, which Abyss was. But, like, him and Taker having those Monsters Ball matches or whatever it is like that, and just it could even play into later on Abyss stuff with the Joseph Park, you know, the identity crisis stuff. That would have been fine, too, but, like, that match is something that we need to have seen. It's a shame we never got him coming to WWE earlier. Again, like you said, it was rumored at some point, but never happened.
You think of how much Abyss made out of his TNA run and having crappy writers and having no production values and still how he was able to get this character over. Think if he'd come over to WWE in 2007, 8, 9, 10, 11 and had their production values to do some vignettes and had their creative forces, you know, as much crap as their creative forces can put out when they do stuff well and when they can kind of play with that sort of stuff, that, you know, just imagining the best case scenario for what they could have come up with to add to that character and tweak it and brand even more, flesh it out even more. And yeah, the matches, the bumps they could have had, man, just
how did it not happen, man? Apparently, Abyss turned. He's the one who turned it down. He wanted to stay with TNA, and he wanted to continue to make them into something bigger. And maybe a mistake, in my opinion. It could have been so much more. But who knows? I guess it could still happen.
Well, I hope he's. I hope he is on SmackDown more nowadays, because it was a blast to see him and AJ on SmackDown together last week. And,
great facial expressions, man.
He's got the William Regal type stuff going on. So,
because he had to do it under a mask for so long.
Exactly. But anyway, that would have been fun. So no more TNA guys, right?
I got no more TNA guys. I mean, everything else I got is sort of, you could kind of put into modern day to an extent.
AEW, NXT, WWE stuff.
You could all blend them all together. What about you?
That's what I got left. Okay. I got one tag match. All right. I'd like to have seen the Brothers Destruction versus the Usos.
Oh my God.
Yes, you kidding me? That would have been great. Just when they're, you know, even the 2000, like when the Usos were, when they come in, 2009 or 10.
They've been around forever.
Yeah, so even that era, because we just covered recently here on Talking Taker when, you know, they teamed up, the Brothers Destruction teamed up on SmackDown, I think it was, or Raw or whatever. Like, just, you talked about how they had that entrance and how they could just, they were coming down the ring to kill whoever's in the ring. Like, they were, you knew they were going to just own people. But, like, seeing them in the Usos would have been fantastic. I'm thinking the Usos 2016, 17, like, the last few years when they really got their characters.
Yeah.
And weren't just the, you know, Samoan guys that yelled and had paint, but, like, that would have been really a lot of fun, man. I think they're the greatest, like, most recent tag team that there is.
I would have loved either incarnation, New Day, man. I love their face paint. And
sure, me too.
The chanting, that was way over with me. I thought that's when they finally started to come into their own and, you know, get some personality. And just them in that sort of Edge and Christian Hardy Boys mold, flying all over the place, taking bumps for taking Kane. Would have been crazy, but then with some confidence and the day one-ish and maybe attacking them backstage and, you know, doing all sorts of that sort of stuff. Man, that's a great call. I had not thought of that. But here's a tag match for you, and I'm going to – this last section will just be anybody modern we can throw in there.
Yeah.
How about the Young Bucks, man? How about the Young Bucks against Undertaker and Kane? How about them throwing – super kicks at them and just putting on a show. It's a very different type of show, but it would be a styles clash for sure, but I'd love to see it.
I didn't even think about that because I just don't see Taker ever saying, yeah, sure, sign me up with these guys, because I think he thinks they're a joke, man. Like, I just know how old school he is. Sure. Like, I don't, but maybe it would teach him a thing or two.
That's why I'd like to see it. Yeah, because no, it'd be absolutely. Such a style.
That, yeah, now that you mention it, that would be fun, you know, to have seen and see what they could get by with and what they, you know, as far as no selling, Taker and Kane are going to, there's already no selling in a Young Bucks match, but like Taker and Kane are going to no sell as part of the character. So like, have to really think outside the box and get some actual psychology to say, what are we going to do to actually make this match seem feasible? So that would have been a fun challenge. But, for both those teams,
you know, the Young Bucks, they sort of do a little tombstone. They're not going to be doing that against Undertaker and Kane. So they'd have to play into that. And, you know, like you mentioned all the critiques of Young Bucks, but they put on a show and they can tell a story. And I think at their best, as far as storytelling goes, especially with some guys where you have to tell a story like Undertaker and Kane, I think it could be something really, really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I didn't think about that. So that would be fun, man. Well, in that same vein, obviously the same vein, but a singles match would be Kenny Omega, you know, Mr. Six-star, seven-star guy. And the reason I'd like to see it is because, you know, some people say he's the next Shawn Michaels or whatever. And I agree. I loved his Japanese matches with Okada, Tanahashi. Those are really, really fun stuff. But, you know, you get critiques too about, like, can you do that on the big stage over here? Can you do it against somebody where you have to wrestle that WWE style? You got to take the crowd on a emotional roller coaster. You know, can you do the near falls that aren't V-trigger over and over again? You know, I would like to have seen the challenge, and I think he would have nailed it, nailed a home run against Taker. But, like, and Taker would have made him knock a home run. You know, he wouldn't have allowed him to do the stuff that doesn't make sense. So I think that would have been fun. It would have been a really big growing thing for Kenny and a really big feather in his cap, man. I would have loved to have seen that. you know, for sure.
Absolutely. You know, you just, Omega's great. He's fantastic. But just imagine him getting to spend some time in the ring with a veteran like The Undertaker, or, you know, that just the added benefits that he could be. He's already great, but you could just make him even greater. It's like, you know, when Kurt Angle was in there with Undertaker,
he
brought the best out of him.
He grew so much.
And I think in like, man, if Undertaker were 10 years younger, that's the kind of guy he would love to be in the ring with and to do something with. Okada, I put him on my list too. A little Tombstone versus Tombstone.
I had nobody else from New Japan, said Kenny, so
I just put him because they both do that. Let me steal an NXT guy from you. I know you got some NXT guys to bring up. NXT UK. How about Walter in the ring with The Undertaker, man?
That would be, you know, that would take me back to like early 90s Undertaker. I'd have to see like him go back to like that kind of, I don't know, that kind of style, man. That'd be fun, though. That would be fun. It'd be slow, but it'd be fun. I think it'd be real exciting.
You think he'd have the balls to chop Undertaker?
Not a chance. I think he'd do it once and he'd get a nasty receipt come back his way.
I think you're right.
I don't think he'd like it. So, yeah, but that would be fun, man. I thought about that. That's fun. Fun. Well, you know, going to stake it in NXT, and again, this guy's not your favorite, but I'm telling you, man, the theatricality and the promos and the vignettes we could get with Velveteen Dream.
Yeah.
Would be amazing.
I thought about it.
What he would wear on his pants or whatever, like, you know, and like he's almost like that gold dustish, Rick Rude-ish kind of guy. Like, and then he part of his character is throwback. Like he comes out like as Hulk Hogan or as Macho Man. Like he could even do that with purple gloves or gray gloves. Yeah, he could. It would be so fun. And I don't know. I would love to have seen Taker get a stint in the NXT, just come down for a one-off on a takeover or whatever and have that as a pay-per-view. So that would have been fun.
No, I thought you were going to say that, so I didn't bother writing it down. But absolutely, man. Like, I don't
I know you're not a big fan of Patrick Clark, but well, I think the Velveteen Dream's character is phenomenal.
Absolutely. He's not my favorite in the ring. I'll just say that. But absolutely, I mean, you can't deny him his screen presence. And like you said, just imagining what his tights would be like or his outfit for that night. You know, the imagination runs wild. So I'd love to see it. No doubt about it. That's another guy. Again, if Taker were 10 years younger, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He'd want that guy called up so he could work with him, man, on the main roster. But speaking of the main roster, a guy. It wasn't on my initial thoughts, but then I was just kind of running through the main roster thinking of guys Taker never faced. And he's a guy, I don't think he's been used as well on the main roster as he was in NXT and previously, but a guy I think Undertaker could get a lot out of, Shinsuke Nakamura, man. Like, facial expressions, the storytelling, the performance those guys could have put on together in the ring. And, you know, he's not cutting any promos. He's not doing anything like that. But those two guys could get that storyline over and that match over in the ring with each other.
You cut some low blows, though, that's for sure.
No doubt. Death Valley blows.
That didn't even cross my radar, man, probably because he hasn't been used so well on the main roster. But, that would be fun. That'd be a lot of fun, dude. I would be super excited about that. I'm excited. Think about that. Well, another guy on main roster who I think deserved a shot at Taker was Kevin Owens, man.
Yeah.
Give me – and that just heel Kevin Owens coming out disrespecting everybody. I mean, he's a good babyface, but he's such a better heel. And just the guy who came out and faced John Cena, that one. You know, the guy that turned his back on his best friend his first night in NXT. I mean – the guy who got the Universal title handed to him, that Kevin Owens, you know, like that would have been fun. And that could have been right when Taker stepped in, was when he got the Universal title handed to him. Like, just step in, like, no, not in my yard. Like, it's not how we do things here, you know. Triple H didn't just hand out stuff here for you. Like, I'm going to go against you. That would have been fun. And it could have happened. I mean, Taker wrestled sparingly back then, but like, what, 2015? He wrestled like four or five times that year, I think, didn't
well,
he?
Well, he faced Kevin Owens at Madison Square Garden, like a six-man tag.
Yeah.
Like, he, yeah. I believe he tombstoned him there yeah, towards the did. End. Yeah, he did. So, but yeah, I think that's, man, had Kevin Owens been around in 2009, 2010, you just,
yep.
you can see that feud happening on SmackDown for like three months. You can see exactly how it plays out. You could plug him in there and just the confidence that Kevin Owens has and just his, just what a jerk he is as a heel and not being afraid of Undertaker getting in his face, but then becoming totally scared when he puts the goozle on him. You could see his facial expressions and his style would have just been really fun to see with Taker.
Oh, yeah. That would have been phenomenal. So,
How about Cesaro, man?
Yes.
How about that? Just the most underrated guy in the... like
all, in all.
Ever.
Yeah.
you can't put him high enough to where he's not underrated, man.
Right.
Just because he can't cut promos, you know? But in the ring, unmatched, dude. Just... the things he can do, the ability that he has, and just imagine his creativity with The Undertaker and the things they could have pulled off. You know, probably would just be like a 1 month, just a kind of a random pay-per-view, you know, like a October pay-per-view match, just for the heck of
matter.
It.
Yeah.
Yeah, but man, it would be an awesome sight to see.
Could have been after WrestleMania 30 with the Battle Royal, if they'd have stuck with that when he won the initial Andre Battle Royal. They obviously, Taker lost that night. The streak was defeated, but you know,
but Cesaro goes with Heyman, you know,
exactly. They can, that it pushed exactly, it writes itself. I'm just trying to think of ways to like would like actually bring him in. That'd have been fun, you know, just see him try to big swing Taker and then Taker just no sells and sits up. That'd have been a blast, man. So, I would love that. So, well, in that kind of same vein, I got a guy who I don't know how he never got a pay per view match with Taker, but I guess it's because Taker's career was winding. A little more sparingly, winding down a little bit ish, but that's Dolph.
Oh, you know? Okay.
Same vein as Mr. Perfect. Like, just literally the same exact reasons I said from Perfect. Just watching him bump and just the fact that he's been around forever and he's never got that. You know, I just thought that would be really cool. And he loses all the big matches, he loses all the little matches. He doesn't have to win anything. He's Dolph Ziggler. He's a good hand, you know, but like, that would have been really fun to have seen, you know.
Kind of takes
guys.
It full circle a little bit where you're talking about Mr. Perfect at the beginning. But I mean, in that same vein, no doubt about it. Well, winding down, I just got a couple more. You just got a few more?
There's a couple I want to just hit kind of real quick, rapid fire at the end. But then, I got a couple more main guys right now.
I'll steal another NXT guy from you. Sort of in that same vein as Kevin Owens, man. How about Keith Lee in there up against
Absolutely.
The Undertaker, man?
Absolutely. I got him written down, too, because, again, it would have been same thing we said about Bigelow. Big guy that can go. But even Keith Lee's even more impressive than Bigelow is. But, like, you know, Taker, when he has an athletic big man in there, it's fun to watch, you know? And, man, and Keith got such a big push with and at Survivor Series and all that stuff with him and Roman, and then at the Royal Rumble with Brock. With Brock, like, who the heck is this guy? Like, that was awesome, man. And like, getting to see Taker do that is just, man, NXT champion versus Taker would have been fun, man.
I just
love that.
I think he's missing the mic skills, man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know. Is that what other people say about him? Because like, when I watch him, I don't feel that charisma. But like, when he's in the ring, man, it's unreal.
Mm-hmm. I used to love watching his stuff in Evolve, man, because back then you didn't have to watch. Nobody had to talk in Evolve; they just wrestle. But like, he's getting better. On
he
the
needs
mic,
a manager.
Man.
Like,
he could use
that
somebody.
Type of guy.
Yeah.
It's like what's his name? The Stokely Hathaway or Malcolm Bivens.
Yep. Yeah,
but
he's
Keith
got the big
Lee.
Indian guys though. Instead,
they can have a stable old school stuff. Man.
Well, I'm gonna go with Seth Rollins. He never got a one-on-one pay-per-view match.
Okay.
I think him, and I'll just throw Dean Ambrose as well. That's fine. I'm gonna mean both of those guys.
Sure.
I didn't want to steal that from you, but like both those guys, Roman got the one pay-per-view match and a tag match as Taker's partner. But like neither one of these guys, from 2012 to now, like they've been on the roster, and neither one of them got a Taker match. You know, I think didn't Taker did he enter. Did he have a triple threat? No, he interfered or something. Did Seth interfere in the Brock versus Taker match, I think, in 2015?
Yes.
So we'll talk about Seth. I think it's, but like he wasn't actually in the match. I think he interfered and cost the match or something. So.
And Undertaker faced Dean Ambrose on SmackDown.
On SmackDown, it was awesome. Yeah.
Oh yeah, man, that's just like
yeah.
Yeah, yeah, what might have been.
But how did they never have a pay-per-view? Like, I just, yeah. Those guys, they just weren't chosen one like Roman was.
Exactly, yeah.
But I love both of those guys.
So. Yeah, those would have both been awesome for very different reasons, I feel like. Yeah. And the promos with Ambrose, mm-hmm. He'd just been able to go be full Ambrose,
like,
full
like
Moxley,
Terry Funk or Roddy
whatever
Piper,
it is. Yeah.
Yeah,
just go crazy. Yeah, it would have been really cool.
The true injustice is that The Undertaker escaped Raw. With his soul still intact.
Not for long. Yeah, we did what we said we were going to do on Monday night. But still, it feels like something's missing. I don't feel total satisfaction. I think it's because the dead man is still walking. He's still breathing. Tonight I face The Undertaker one-on-one, and I got an itch that needs scratching. I'm going to do what nobody's been able to do in 21 WrestleManias. Tonight, I'm going to beat The Undertaker.
What? How about a pair of guys? This would be tough, but I believe in these two guys. I believe in their ability to make a story out of something. The juxtaposition, the size juxtaposition would have been very hard to get over, but I'm going to say Gargano and Ciampa, man. Like, two of the best... In NXT, one of the best storylines ever. I just think, I don't know, man. I would have liked to have seen how they could make that, both those guys could make things work with Undertaker. The size difference might have been too difficult to overcome.
That, yeah.
But I think both those guys are talented enough where I would have liked to have seen him try.
Oh, sure, man. And I didn't write Gargano down because I couldn't figure out a way to make it sensibly work. But, yeah, I think he deserves it, and that would have been a fun match. But I did write Ciampa down. But here is a little bit of history. Getting revenge for that lawyer gimmick.
There you go, man. That's
yeah,
it.
Back in the day. So that's why I think Ciampa should have got that one match with him. But that would have been fun. But, yeah, both those guys are phenomenal and would have loved that.
Maybe it's babyface Gargano. You know, maybe it's like he's the Rey Mysterio role. You know?
Sure.
And yeah. It's, I mean, yeah. He plays perfect. Great in that role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd have been great, man. Well, another guy who's back in NXT, and again, this is entrances alone, man, Finn. I mean, Finn Balor.
Yeah. Just, that's obvious one.
That's obvious, dude. Like, just, again, same thing as Sandman, like, but if you get a better match, but like, just the entrances, the theatricality would have been phenomenal, off the charts, would have been so fun. I would have loved to have seen it. It's not going to happen. Finn is... Great, he's really small compared to Taker, but again, he could have played that Rey Mysterio role. You know, it would have been fun.
That's one. It felt like it had to happen. It felt like it was definitely mm-hmm. gonna happen when the Demon was really getting over and getting big, and in 2015 and 16, it just felt like that has to happen. We gotta get a Demon versus Undertaker
mm-hmm.
entrance. But that injury that Finn Balor got, that just
derailed a lot
totally
of that stuff.
Has derailed his career in a lot of ways. It's just never been the same. It's never been on that same trajectory, man. It's just such a shame. And he's still young enough to where, you know, there's still a lot more to come from him, I hope, and where they can kind of recover that. But, man, that's – yeah, how did that
missed
not happen? Alternate
yeah.
universe, man. Should have happened.
Yep, absolutely. You got some more NXT guys?
No, I've just got one more – Main guy. Roster
Let's
guy.
Save him. I know who
I think,
that is.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Let's,
yeah.
We should end with him because he's probably
so
the guy. Yeah. All right. Well, I got just a couple more. I'll just kind of fire them off real quick. And again, a Matt Riddle because same thing you said about Angle earlier. I would have loved to have seen him being the bro, not take it seriously, kick his shoes off, and just take her just like, you got to have respect for this business. Like, that, like as a character, you know, like that would have been fun. And again, I love Matt Riddle in the ring. I absolutely love this guy in the ring. He's phenomenal to
Taker
me.
Taker could have taught him a lot. I see that.
Yeah.
I see that storyline playing out. And
yes.
You know, Taker, Riddle gives him a run for his money. They're doing a submission. Taker turns it into Hell's Gate. Riddle
mm-hmm.
taps out, passes out. I don't know how you want to do it, but Taker gets up, gives him the handshake.
Exactly.
You know, puts him over at the end.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that.
Love that. Love that. Elias, just because I thought we were going to get it. We thought we were going to get it. That's what I'm saying. This is a missed opportunity because I literally thought we were going to get it back in 2018?
Yeah.
I think it was 19 maybe even too. But That would have been fun. And
I didn't necessarily want it, but I did. No. It did feel like we were going to get it, and it kind of like.
That's why I wrote it down.
Felt like unfinished business.
Yeah. And then another guy with, would have been a different style, but again, entrances again, and the characters would have been awesome. As Aleister Black, man, I just thought that was, you know, him coming out of the grave, and, you know, his theme song is, you know, they say no man is truly good, it's no man is truly evil. Like, that would have been, you could have played into the lyrics of his theme song and just all his iconography all over his tattoos and what it all stands for. I mean, that would have been, you could have played that with back in the Biker Taker era or in this, you know, Taker nowadays. It would have been fun to have seen that. But again, entrances at WrestleMania, imagine those two coming out. That would have been a blast.
Are you kidding me? Yeah, like, it's another guy I think NXT has used better than the main roster has. It's just something, it seems like there's so much more to that character, to that gimmick. Oh, yeah. Than what they're doing with him, and felt like they were getting closer to it with the stuff where he's in the room and somebody knocking on the door.
Imagine Taker knocks on the door. Yeah.
Like that, there's so much potential there. But they just, I don't know, man. And he's another guy, when he opens his mouth, that kind of goes away from me, man. Mm-hmm. Like
It doesn't match the toughness of his body, his exterior, his voice doesn't. You're right.
He should talk less or have a manager or something, or only say one word or something like that. I don't know. But Andrade could have had some great matches with Taker. Mm-hmm. Ricochet. I don't know if those are pay-per-view matches, but you could do some fun stuff. I mean, so many guys, so much talent that be interesting to see Taker work with this younger generation that can do so many dives and flying things. Yeah. And you know, they still, Ricochet tells a great story in the ring. He's a phenomenal guy. Kofi Kingston, you know, the New Day guys would have been interesting to see Taker interact with those guys. Maybe a Biker Taker against the funny New Day.
Great. Well, I got two more guys, then we'll finish off with the one I think we're going to finish on. So again, Baron Corbin, I know you don't like him, but he's talked about how Taker had helped him, literally helped him. Like when he comes on the PC, like, he helps him understand what to do and what not to do. Like he's like, you know, he owes a lot to Taker. So I think I would have liked to have seen that. Again, this King Corbin, I don't know about that, but like the early on Corbin, the lone wolf guy, even right when he came to the main roster, I liked that character. I really did. I liked how he didn't do a lot in the ring, but I like how far he's come. I like he's got the X-Pac heat, man. I love it because he makes me hate him. He's a heel. I love that he makes me hate him. I love that. I would like to have seen him with Taker just because he respects Taker and Taker respects him because he's taught him a lot down in NXT. So
no,
that's just,
man,
like a personal one.
I got those Undertaker vibes from NXT Corbin as well in the early days. And then, but yeah, like King Corbin and Roman Reigns, that was some good stuff. Some of that went on forever, it felt like, but there was some good stuff in there, and I could see Taker putting him in his place, and that's an easy pay-per-view match for sure.
Yep. And then my last one, and then we'll end on the big guy, but it's Karrion Kross. I just think his character is fun. I liked Killer Kross. I enjoyed watching his stuff on the indies and stuff, and really enjoyed it, and I like what he's doing. They're building him up as a monster in NXT right now. As of this, when this episode drops, he may or may not be the NXT champion tomorrow. Who knows? But I love what they're doing with him. Entrance, I like his entrance. I like the no sell, the storytelling. It's very reminiscent of an early Taker with a 2020 spin on it. So I would have liked to have seen these two guys go at it nowadays. I could see a months long pay per view feud between these two guys.
Yeah, I haven't really watched him much. I've just seen little bits and pieces, but you know, from what I've seen, I could see that too. Yeah.
And he's a really smart dude, like behind the scene. Like he's a really intelligent guy. I think him and Taker could really put some good stuff together. And he thinks outside the box with regards to his promos and his TikTok stuff and all his iconography and stuff he has. So really would have been cool. You know, to have seen them. But that's it for NXT and new era guys, except for the one we're going to end on here, which I know you and I both have him down as the top missed opportunity of the last 10 years.
Well, you know, I think Sting is probably what most people say, sure. And maybe Andre the Giant right there, as you're talking about legends that you'd like to see in there with Undertaker. But there was a guy that, as people were talking about this past WrestleMania, or, you know, if Undertaker is going to retire, who's going to be the guy that could take him on? And AJ Styles was one of those top two guys.
Mm-hmm. And love it.
The Boneyard match was fantastic. It was great. Wouldn't change it at all. Such a great match. But as our buddy Jay Stanley said on Facebook, you know, if Undertaker were to ever come back and decide to do it one more time, I think there is one guy that could pull something magical and special out of him. Of course, we're talking about Dean Malenko. Jay did say him. But,
Jay did say Dean.
Huge Dean Malenko
Jay's
fan.
Boy. Yeah.
And so are we. I would have loved to see too. He said he's the only man that can make Undertaker tap out. But this guy might be able to as well. We're talking about Daniel Bryan. And
yes.
We're talking about Daniel Bryan, his arrival into the WWE. We'll talk about it a bit on next week's episode as we get into that part of 2010 in our era. Would you have ever guessed watching that little kid in the red pants and the, you know, 120 pounds, no beard, clean cut hair? Would you have ever said he'd be one of the top guys that should have faced The Undertaker?
No, I did not think that he would go on. I really liked American Dragon. I really liked his independent stuff, his Ring of Honor stuff. I knew he was a student of Shawn Michaels, but I never saw him becoming the guy that he is. You know, I really didn't. I don't think any of us did. I mean, we knew he was going to be a star, but was he going to be him WrestleMania headliner? No, I didn't see that. I didn't see us ever saying, like you said, oh yeah, that's the one that got away from Taker. That, you know, but that's true, man. He is the one. It would have been the best of the Kurt Angle style matches, the best of the Shawn Michaels style matches, the best of the Bret Hart matches. Think of those three guys that Taker wrestles so well, and he may have taken it to another level than what those three guys could do. I mean, seriously, like, it would have been nuts.
Book him as a heel. Book him as a babyface. Sure. Have him be the Planet's champion. Have him be yes, yes, yes. Yeah, like you said, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if Taker's a heel or babyface.
No.
You could do face-to-face match and have it work. Give these guys 30 minutes. You know, Daniel Bryan is so good. He could work around whatever ailments Undertaker is having. Yes. He's little enough that Taker can, you know, even how whatever shape Taker's in, I'm sure he'd get him up for a choke slam or a tombstone or do whatever he needs to. I mean, it's like him and AJ Styles, I don't know, it's 1A, 1B, both great wrestlers, both great storytellers, both could talk and both could get it over in their own unique ways. They did tag team together, you know, during the Team Hell No Day. They had that six man against the Shield.
The Shield,
right after WrestleMania, and that was phenomenal. And so, man, it's another one that you hold out that tiniest sliver of hope. Maybe, possibly, it could still happen one day if the timing is right, if the money is right, if the storyline is right. Who knows? But yeah, you just, the greatest underdog in WWE history against the Phenom, against the greatest legend.
That's the story right there. That's it. I mean, he just comes out and after Royal Rumble one year and just says, this is me and you. Like, it's, you know, I've got the yes movement, but I've never, you know, I've main evented WrestleMania. I've opened WrestleMania and closed it on the same night that you lost your streak. You know, that means I'm better than you at WrestleMania. I don't know. You could have done something like that, but like, the one thing I've never done is beat you at WrestleMania or face you ever. So that would have been awesome, man.
And you pull in Shawn Michaels to it. You pull in his trainer and have Shawn Michaels telling him, no, don't do this. Or have Shawn Michaels be in his corner and be like, I couldn't do it, but you're going to be the one to do it. You know,
Done.
Yeah, seriously, I'm there. Book it. Yeah, make it happen.
That would have been awesome, man. That would have been awesome. But yeah, that's Sting. The top three that are never on pay-per-view for me were Sting, Chris Jericho, and Daniel Bryan.
Okay.
That's...
I'll say top three, Sting. Man, that's tough, dude. It's so tough.
Well, I didn't mean to like put you on the spot. I was just saying.
Oh, okay.
Like, those are the three like just come out immediately. Like, the first three I wrote down was that. Those were them.
I love the Sting match, of course. I love Daniel Bryan. Dude, I'm loving the Scott Steiner idea. I'm totally, totally digging that. Abyss is a big one. Could have been really special. Great Muta, I love that one. I love that idea. Brothers of Destruction, Steiner Brothers. Man, I'm seeing that play out. I loved the Taker Razor Ramon idea that you had. That could have been really fun, man. Just so many classics that we never got to have. But we've done so many classics over the past 158 episodes, over the past 3 years of doing this podcast. So we want to hear from you guys. We want to hear about your favorite ideas for The Undertaker that we never got to see. But for now, we want to encourage you to go back into the 3 years of archives of all the matches we did get to see, and be sure to stick around with us for the next few months or so as we wind down the podcast, as we cover the final 10 years of The Undertaker's career. It's going to fly by fast. We got a few other little ideas, little brainstorms like this to sort of extend the podcast a little bit. But let us know what you thought of this experiment. A couple hours talking about, man, we must have covered 50, 60 guys or so here easily. And I'm sure, and I know we're missing some. Just going through the comments,
I just thought of one that I have written down that we didn't even talk about, and that's Owen Hart.
Yeah, but, I thought about that too.
I have him written down, but it didn't work out to talk about him. But yeah, and it may not have worked out storyline wise. But anyway, yeah, just there's plenty more we could have gone into, but these are just, you know, top ones I really felt like were missed, and actually could think of a storyline for most of them. So.
Yeah, let me just run through a few of you guys. Of course, we're always asking for your comments on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at TalkingTaker. So many. Just trying to hit some highlights here. St. Ridley Santos said his top five: Savage, Demon, Finn Balor, Great Muta, Andre, Sting. Zach L217 said Bobby Lashley. We didn't mention that one. Could have been something there.
We did not mention that one.
I'm digging Bobby Lashley nowadays, man. This is the best he's ever been with the...
Yeah, you know why? Because he got MVP.
Bingo. Philip Goad talked about... LTB. He's the one that brought up Brothers of Destruction and the Steiners. Dusty Rhodes.
Phil.
Come on, man.
Well, he was in that Survivor Series, so that's why I didn't put him down.
But singles.
Singles would have been great, down, yeah.
Minoru Suzuki, Dead Man versus Murder Grandpa, dude. Seriously?
I don't think Taker would sign up for that.
I'm in it, man. I'm in it to win it. Benjamin Emerson said, Muta is 57 and still going today, so maybe they could still do something with him and Taker, dude. Why the heck not?
Cinematic.
Greetings from Allentown Podcast. This is on my list. I skipped over it. But Earthquake versus Undertaker would have been a fun big man battle. Funny thing is, they went from heel to face at almost the exact same time. So that's probably why it didn't happen.
Yeah, it's true.
That could have been fun. Watch Along Tommy, Watch Along Wrestling. This is not quite what we were saying, but I do like this idea. He said, big one for me would have been for Edge to not be in Money in the Bank at 23, so that his match with Taker at 24 could have been the battle of the undefeated streaks. So that's sort of in the same lines as what we're talking about, sort of changing the booking. But he also brought up one I never would have thought of, but I could see it working. Ryback. Undefeated Ryback against Undertaker around WrestleMania 29 time. Ryback was over, man. I didn't like him, but you can't deny he was over.
You can't deny he was over, man. Well, we got Punk and Taker at WrestleMania 29, so I'm happy with that.
Princeton John said Braun Strowman. Didn't mention him, but that's another obvious one.
Obvious one, yeah.
Brody Lee, whatever you want to do him as Luke Harper. Brody Lee,
and
Dark
tag
Order.
Match.
Tag match, yeah. Never had singles match, but super, super talented. guy. Awesome performer.
He's like a Mike Awesome-ish type guy, like where he can do, well, he's not quite as big, but I'm just saying, like, as far as a big-ish guy, he's agile. So.
G. Seidel, 1990. Must be an old-school guy, because he threw in two I never would have thought of. Yes. Gorilla Monsoon and Stu Hart.
Son of a gun.
What the heck, man? I'll take it, man.
Take him.
I'll
watch stretching. It.
I don't think I've ever seen a Stu Hart match.
Stretch you in there.
I don't think I've ever actually seen him wrestle.
Oh, me neither.
But I'll watch it.
They didn't have cameras back then when he wrestled. I was like 614 when he died.
Lots of people saying Sabu. I think that was a big one.
Sure.
People wanting to see. Finn Balor, Lou Avia, Boogeyman and Taker could have had a great cinematic style match.
Yes.
Sure. You know, we didn't explore this promotion at all, because I've never really watched it. I've seen only a couple episodes, but Reverend Cody Khan said, I always kind of wanted an Undertaker Mil Muertes showdown, but that was several years ago. Not sure I'd want Taker to step in there with him now.
Okay, from Lucha?
Yeah. I never really watched
that. Who was Mil Muertes? Was that... I can't remember who that was underneath the mask there. Never mind. Okay, I just looked him up. I was thinking it was Brian Cage, but it's not. It's Ricky Banderas. Never mind. Okay.
Yeah.
So... All right. Well, yeah. I mean, I could see that as far as, you know, the kind of the pillar that he was for Lucha Underground and kind of the role he played. That makes sense.
I like it. Creative. And then I know you had some Facebook comments as well.
Yeah, Mark Short. Been digging our stuff, and he said his fantasy bookings would be Dynamite Kid, Owen Hart, Sting, Andre, and Arn Anderson. So, okay. You know. Three. We talked about. One I just happened to mention a second ago, and then Dynamite Kid. That would have been interesting, to say the least. So, and then he also said, Mark also said that he loves the show discussions. He picks up on things we didn't originally notice, and he loves the good dad jokes that we have.
Hey, now.
Didn't have too many this time, Mark. I'll don't worry. Stay tuned next week. I'm sure I'll drop a few. So.
And then, like we said, Jay Stanley, of course, he brought up. Daniel Bryan, Dean Malenko, Randy Savage, the madness cutting insane bananas promos on early day Zombie Taker, but Taker just standing there building Macho's casket while he rambles about coffee creamer would have been great. I love that idea, Jay. Thank you for that.
That creamer and coffee goes right well with your Oreos from Josh's oven. So that was Jay. Those of you listening, saw the pictures on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. That's Jay, our buddy, digging the Oreos out of Josh's oven. And I go back to last week's episode to see what we're talking about there.
Well, we thank you guys for joining us for this little excursion, this detour, taking our time traveling hearse, not back in time, but I guess into an alternate universe of Undertaker's career, what it might have been in another world, in another realm. We'll get back to our normal timeline next week as we keep rolling onto the last ride. We're going to roll on over to Night of Champions 2010, Last Man Standing match against Kane. We're going to cover so much ground as The Undertaker sits in a vegetative state. But you can go back to last week's episode to catch up.
We will not, though.
Never, man. WrestleMania 26, threw a poll up on the Twitter, and you guys voted overwhelmingly, 73-27%. You guys settled it. WrestleMania 25 better than WrestleMania 26. Agreed with us. I thought it was going to be closer from the way people reached out. But there it goes. It's settled once and for all. And I just want to say here, I won't get too mushy because we're not too far from our series finale. So I'll save most of it for then. But thank you for supporting us for 3 years. I had no idea it was going to go on this long. Had no idea we'd actually commit to it and stick around. And it's so awesome to have each and every one of you comment and interact. This episode was perfect for that because we got to interact with so many of you. And that's why we do it. So that was made this so much fun. And thank you, Travis, for your commitment to it. And it's been a pleasure spending every Tuesday nights when we record usually. So spending every Tuesday with you and then listening back to you in my ears every Friday when it comes out. Man, it's been a blast. Nobody else I'd rather talk Taker with. So here's to a few more months of doing it.
Likewise. Yeah, I look forward to it every week. And Can't wait to do a few more until we, bury this dead man. And well, maybe, unless we need to break the glass. If Vince calls, we'll get him out. Yeah, so we'll see. But, and again, I can't really do an if you were there because these are all fantasy matches. But but I will throw this challenge out. You know, as of this recording, they haven't had the signups for the WWE Thunderdome. But those of you paying attention know that they're going to have fans in the audience via, the LED boards or whatever. So if you can sign up to be on the WWE Thunderdome, right, whether it's Raw, SmackDown, SummerSlam, Payback, which is a pay-per-view a week after SummerSlam, go figure.
Excuse me?
There's a pay-per-view the next week, the next Sunday.
We're talking UK days, man.
Yeah, exactly. Well, if you can get onto one of these WWE programs in our Talking Taker shirt, we will have a big surprise for you. And trust me, I'll be signing up as many times as I can to try to get on these shows. I can't wait. I want to wear some Talking Taker merch on USA television. So
I like it.
But anyway, yeah, if you will be there, let us know if you try to sign up for Thunderdome. And but if you
Thunderdome.
if you were there when Mean Mark Red Big Booger Texas Pete wrestled Bruiser Brody, let us know. So if you were there. If you're still alive and listening to this, you get a special prize as well.
Or if you were there at one of these matches in another universe, definitely, please, by all means, reach out to us.
Tell us how it was. Yeah.
Tell us how we can travel to your timeline and get out of this terrible one.
Yeah, we'd love to leave 2020 in the current year, the timeline we live in. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, other than that, again, thanks for 3 years. We look forward to a few more months of this. And as always, stay safe, and most importantly, take her easy.
It was written before we had even walked. It was spoken by the gods a long time ago. It was said by me that in answering each challenge that confronts us, there would be others right behind them with new experiences. But in this experience we have just had, who do we relate to? With breath still in the lungs, with fluid still in our bodies, placed inside a closed casket, no one but us can understand. But we have been back to the place we came from. Now we are back to the place where we must exist. And you, Undertaker, are the one that must pay.